Good evening and welcome to Tinkering with Etkelar. Since my next larger project is on hold because some spare parts are stuck in limbo and customs, I'll present you with another promised little project. The little CNC mill I got for the Commodore plotter restoration. I was hesitant at first, since normally I prefer manual tooling over CNC, but with how tiny and precise that part had to be, I saw no alternative for a homemade version. A quick PSA. I looked for a cheap one online that looked at least somewhat sturdy. Remember, I'm getting most of my tools from an "oh, I need this now" impulse, so while I am aware that a more expensive version would be much better, I have no idea how often I would be using that tool, so I follow the premise: buy a cheap entry model first and then maybe get a schmick version later if needed. But most of the time the cheap version works good enough for me, so I save overall. It arrived as a kit. Fair enough. I can assemble something like this. Let's unpack it. The frame is made from some aluminium extrusions in one direction and some phenolic paper in the other. The latter ones had a bit of a burr on them, so I sanded that off. The Z-axis unit came assembled. Aww. But at least it seems sturdy. I can't feel any play. This bodes well. Just a bit of the usual factory grime to dust off. Oh, and a bit of plastic shaving inside the block. Seems that when they pushed in the linear bearings, they chafed the plastic slightly. Again, a bit of cleanup, but nothing serious so far. Table is extruded aluminium too, again with a bit of a burr, which I'm sanding off slightly out of frame. Sorry, I was too excited to watch the camera. Here's a quick overview of the parts. The Z-axis head, the spindle motor with the cullet, two stepper motors for X and Y, some lead screws and connecting rods for the linear bearings, which are here, the motor controller, the base plate with some cute little T-slots, and the pieces that make up the frame. The latter ones have the ball bearings for the spindle pre-fitted. Oh, and there's some wires and a whole lot of screws, some springs and Allen keys. Also included was a power supply. The building instructions are simple enough. The typical connect part A with slot B type. And since this isn't a test, you can peek ahead to the solution in case some part's orientation isn't perfectly clear on the current page. No problem there. Well, I got so caught up in the question whether the ball bearing is an innie or outie that I completely forgot to put the linear bearings on the rails. I keep the parts loosely connected at first, so that any tolerance in the screws can be used to my advantage when the plate is fixed. These things have to be absolutely parallel so they don't bind up. The stepper motor and spindle are connected with a sleeve and some grub screws. The spindle is attached to the nut with a spring-loaded counter nut. That takes out the slack in the movement. Be sure to add a pinch of oil. And another deja vu moment. The lead screw only fits into the ball bearing straight on, which means remove the stepper to get that in first. The plate gets mounted to the bearing blocks with self-locking T-nut fasteners. Thread them on the blocks, slide the plate over, and tighten down the screws. Oh, and the blocks have their holes slightly offset. I choose to mount them on the outer edge of the plate for maximum rigidity and travel. Be sure to align the plate as parallel to the frame as possible. And always check if anything binds up during assembly. It's much easier to fix if you are aware what screw caused it to bind in the first place. The vertical assembly that holds the second axis is also connected with the same type of fasteners. It is a bit wobbly until tightened. Be sure to set it at a right angle to the main frame elements. I lined up the back edge with the rear frame piece and made sure that they don't overlap. One of the longer rails had a nick in it. A bit of careful sanding took care of that. Again, some of the arrows were not quite as clear on one page, so I had to reposition. And here's why you tighten the screws on the linear rails only when the sliding part is in place. Same spring-loaded nut for this lead screw. The lead screw bearing is easily the one piece with the tightest tolerance. It will only fit straight on, no ifs or buts about it. The vertical pieces should be parallel, of course. I put them snug against the back of the frame, which has a slight overhang. It would be much easier if that overhang were a bit larger. And after attaching the spindle motor, it is time for the controller board and wiring. controller comes in a clear case and goes to the rear frame rails. This is finally a point where I can show the self-locking T-nuts of the set. The stepper wires are certainly long enough. The driver set might be the same for larger versions of the device. Still, very straightforward. Just be sure to connect the X, Y, and Z motors to the right sockets. These are not coded, just labeled. And a bit of wire management and cable ties later, the device is now ready for a test run. The controller comes with a little manual console. That could use a slightly less homemade design, but it does work, and it has an included SD card slot to run some G-code without a computer. After a quick dry run with one of the included sample files, I used double-sided tape to hold down a piece of plastic for the first real test with the same sample. The mill doesn't have any awareness of its position in space. There are no limit switches of any sort. It is totally up to you to position the cutter at the origin of your G-code and then hit start. And pray. The only real project so far was the spring plate for the Commodore plotter, which worked fine. It only took a dozen tries to find out that the controller crashes badly when the G-code uses line feeds instead of carriage returns and line feeds. To summarize, I think this model is a decent enough entry-level tool if you are up for the some assembly required step. What irks me the most is the lack of limit switches, leading to some very annoyed stepper motors if you ever run out of travel. These two microswitches would not break the bank in the bill of materials, and I bet the controller could also be modified with two inputs. And that's it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed this little combined build and review video. See you next time! Which means, remove the stepper! Not the stellar. What the was I writing?